Welcome everyone to the EEA Global Summit 2021. This is Sujat from EEA Global Summit organizing team. It's our privilege to have Jan D. Lifty from Collectives in our presence, presenting using Enterprise Architect in the process of retrofitting industrial system. And I also thank everyone for your interest in joining this session. And for your kind information that we will be muting all the participants throughout the session. So please use the chat window to drop your questions to the speakers. Your queries will be answered at the end of the session. So we request everyone to visit the allotted Microsoft Teams channel to communicate with Jan and other EA practitioners after the session. Jan and the other speakers accepted to stay in the channel to have a one-to-one discussion and answer all your queries. The link to the MS Teams channel is posted in the chat window for your quick reference. If you have any difficulties in connecting to Teams, please let us know through the chat window or write us at the registrations at eaglobalsummit.com. Thanks once again for your interest and support to the EA Global Summit 2021. Without any further ado, I'll request Jan to start his presentation. Over to you, Jan.
Hello, welcome everybody. Do you see? Can you confirm that you see my presentation?
Not yet, John. Yeah, perfect. Now I can see your presentation.
Yes. Okay.
Yes.
Thank you.
Good.
Well, everybody, welcome to this presentation. In the next 45 minutes, I will take you in a closer look. We can use Enterprise Architect in retrofitting industrial systems. My name is Ander Lietzen. I work as system engineer in the infrastructure and industrial domain. And we have a strong focus on model-based engineering. And I believe that a model-based approach where we can work together from one single source of truth as an alternative for a document approach, so that we can minimize miscommunication risk on schedule and budget overruns during the delivering of better systems during the whole system lifecycle. I have some definition from the internet about what retrofitting is. The name retrofit is often used in the industry, but mostly about the combination of modifying, replacing, or adding new parts to a system. It's very important to look at these kind of systems. They're very, very big. You see some pictures of it, and the issues that we have to account in this approach. Systems or parts of it are end of life. Most of these systems are built for 50 to 100 years. So a lot of systems are, especially parts of it, are end of life after 10, 15 years, some 25, the civil part mostly at 80 years. Another issue that we encounter is that people with knowledge of the processes and the systems are retiring. So a lot of knowledge is leaking out of where we're working for. Documentation is outdated, incomplete, splintered over a lot of sources. That's also a problem. And it doesn't meet the performance requirements, or we have new performance requirements. These are the issues that we have to solve within retrofitting an industrial system. So we have set up two goals for the model that we would like to build. One is it should act as a single source of truth for all different kind of people, discipline engineers, maintenance engineers, asset managers, the testing group, management. But it also has to act as a knowledge base for all these kind of people. So during your life cycle, a lot of knowledge is leaking out, and we have to store it in what we call mono. Therefore, we have we use a top-down and a middle and bottom-up analysis that we also call the middle-out analysis to recover the E situation and to define the solve situation that we like to reach. So the goal of the middle-out analysis is to define the deviation between the existing system that's already over there and the intended system. So the result and the is the definition between the actual usability and the intended usability, the actual system and the existing documentation, and the deviation between the existing capability services that the system have to deliver and the the needed capabilities and services that the system has to deliver in the future. So we analyze the existing usability as an each situation, the intended usability as a soul, and we have to analyze the not completed system documentation for the each situation, and we have to look at the real system in life, mostly on the plant, how the system looks like in reality. Here are some pictures about the east and the situation from the top-down approach. So we have to look what are the current capabilities and services that the system delivers at this time, and what the capability services will deliver in the future. So we can build up the different operational scenarios, interaction between all the system and external systems, and the users of the system. We have to build up the east structure of the system, how it's today and how it will be in the future. That's from a functional approach. From the bottom-up approach, we look at the actual plant, and that's what are the electrical systems are over there, the mechanical. How does it look in the civil components? How is the industrial automation functionality for? And how does the structure will look now and will look in the future? So when we have to define a project scope for a retrofit project, we have to minimize the deviation between the east and the soul situation. Criteria for that are performance, what's the actual performance and what's the performance that we needed in the future. How much budget do we have? What's the time schedule that we have to deliver it? And what's the technology that we can use and what's already there and will not be replaced? So we have to have a maximum deviation at start, and we have to try to the minimum. In best case, that will be zero. Therefore, we have to define and analyze the design concept. You see a horizontal and a vertical line. In the vertical, we look at the black box, not only from the system, but also from the system parts. We look at the white box, we look at the technology that's been used within the system and what kind of products are used and will be used in the future. On the horizontal, we look at from the requirements, from the user, stakeholders, all these kind, the system requirements and the product requirements. We have to define also the behavior of the system and the functionality. And structure, how does the structure of the system look like? What kind of system parts? But also what kind of products are used within the system parts. We have to verify against the requirements and the needs of the stakeholders and the users of the system. And we have to do some certain analysis. We can also use simulation to do for validation and verification purpose. All these elements will be presented in the next slides of it, and what we have built for it and how we can use it. We have also the different analyses at the operational level. That's the black box approach, the functional analyses, and design for the white box. Technology, what kind of technology is already there and what will be there in the future? And how does the configuration look at the moment and how will it, does it look in the future? Therefore, we have to build up a structure for the different models within the single source of truth. We have an operational model where all the user goals, user capability services, and operational scenarios are stored in. We have a functional model for the east and the soul situation. We have a technological model where all the solutions are building or modeling. And we have an implementation model where the configuration from the products is stored. We have to also use different modeling languages. There's not one modeling language to model the system at the whole. So we have to offer information for communication with the different disciplines in such a project. Therefore, we use, in common case, we use SysML as a generic modeling language. But we have to provide the model with domain-specific information about piping and the process, about operational scenario, for example, or for the analyzers. And we can use Simulink, Simscape, and MATLAB for the simulations also. Traceability is the backbone for successful projects using a model. Traceability within the different models are between the horizontal, this in the model itself, and over the different models. So the functional analyzers, the results from that, and the design have to traceable to the operational, and also the configuration has to be traced back to the operational analysis. So what kind of products are we using to deliver some kind of services or capability to the users? we know three kinds of requirements within a model. We have customer requirements that are the basis to define the east and social situation from a customer point of view and the user point of view. Therefore, from that point, we started with defining the system requirements so we can fill in the white box and design it and analyze it. And at the end, we have to define product requirements for what kind of product we're going to buy for using within the system. We use use cases for the defining of the different capability and services for the existing system and for the intended system. By using the version and the status of these kind of elements and show them on a diagram and use the filtering of enterprise architect, we can show the difference between the existing and the intended usability. Operational scenarios. We use system activity diagrams. It's also possible to use there for BPM, for example. That's if that fits more by the people you have to discuss with in the project. Operational scenarios are used for the validation of the system at the end when it will be delivered. So they can set up the operational test cases and validate the system after transition to operational use. System interaction between the system, the uses of the system, and also the external systems. are realized by the sequence diagrams, and the sequence diagrams should be the basis for setting up test cases for the verification of the system itself. We have to define domain-specific toolboxes for doing an hazard analysis. The hazard analyses are mostly used within the industrial and infrastructure systems, so that we see all the risks for users of the system, and define the different mitigation solutions for it, in the order of requirements, capabilities, or functions. When we look at the white box, then we have to define all the different kind of system states of the white box itself. It's also for all the system elements within the system itself. We have to define all the states, because it's very important that functionality is only active in one or more states. We call it also a state-based design, and therefore we mitigate the risk of being in a deadlock of the system or parts of the system. So every black box should have a state transition diagram with all the different states that can be in, and all the transitions of it. System functions are related to the different states of the system itself, or from the system parts. And we have also defined the product and information flow between the different functionalities that are over there. We have to define the sequence and the information and product flow. And products can be in the order of energy, force, gas, liquid, and these kind of things. When we look at the system structure, we use also SysML as the modeling language for it. But we have to find the structure, and we can give information about what kind of flow is there between all the structure elements. Energy, chemicals, liquid, gas, these kind of things. Also the performance was expected in the form of pressure, flow, but also the mean time between failure and mean time to repair, what we expect as a budget. What kind of, how much power is a system element using, for example. And we can provide some the definition of the asset information that we use by asset managers and maintenance engineers. When we look at the analysis of the failure modes, we have to define, depending on functionality, the usability of the system. So defining the use cases, what are the failure modes within the functional system itself that can cause a failure, a loss of function, or degraded function, for example. We have to define that, and we can analyze what kind of mitigations we have to build in the system. And if we look at the existing documentation, a lot of functions that are already in the system itself are a mitigation of all these kind of failure modes. So if you make you define the functionality of the system in mitigation functions and the primary functions of the system itself, then it will be less complex to design the system itself. So we look at the failure modes at two levels. One in the functional, that's when functions are degraded or lost, and we look at the technological failures of the system. Can we also do for the fault tree analysis? We can set up a budget for the for the availability or the failure rate of the system, and at the end we build up the fault tree based on the product information from the producers of the system, of the system products. And that will be done when the configuration is ready. When we have to build up a product, and we can set up a fault tree in the vertical way of the system. So, and mostly in the actual products, only the failure rates and the availability is based on the products and not on the budget. We have to discuss with a lot of discipline engineers within this kind of system. They are technology based, so we have to provide them with diagrams and information in a way they can understand. The SysML diagrams are mostly very difficult for these people and very abstract. So we have to provide them with, for example, PIDs and energy one-eye schemes. We also can give the performance and the asset information that we expected when the products are bought, and therefore we build up some toolboxes to model these kind of diagrams. And you see two examples of it. That can we also do for the industrial automation part of it. So we look at the actual automation grade of the system, and we can design and define the intended automation grade of the system itself. It's very important. That's why you see in the concept diagram that we have all the relation defined between industrial automation, mechanical parts of it, electrical parts of the system, and also to the functionality of that's intended to be delivered at the end. At the end, we can build up a configuration from the east and the south situation. So what is the equipment and all the elements, all the products in the field itself, in the plant. And from the design, we will then have a deviation between the actual configuration and the intended configuration. We need that for defining a plan how we can migrate the system parts of it from old to new. What have we terminated from the system, what we have to replace or we have to renew. What you saw in the bottom-up approach, not only the electrical automation and mechanical parts of the system have to analyze, but we have to also look at how does the civil part of it, for example. That's mostly built in 3D the BIM models that a lot of companies are using, and we have to integrate it within the enterprise architect model, because all the products that we and the system elements that we are designing have to be placed within the civil structure. So we have built an add-on so that we can read an IFC file, for example, of an IFC definition, and we can integrate then all the definitions of the different elements that are the walls and the floors, rooms, all these kind of cable conduct. If we have that, we can look at the instances of it. So how much floors do we have? How much walls? How much doors? And what kind of door is it? How many cable conduits are there over there? And we have to integrate it in the system model, and we can make up the relationship between these several parts of it. And for example, we have a room, we have a floor over there in a room, and we have a pump, and that has to be placed within the civil structure. So now we can really integrate it, the civil parts of it. That's actual designed by the civil engineers, and we can integrate it within the industrial system itself. Another thing, when we integrate it, we can also hyperlink to the parts within the 3D model, and we can navigate from our enterprise architect or from Collaborate to the different elements within the 3D model. For the certification, we have different kind of levels. We have to make it traceable from the bottom to the top and from the top to the bottom. And the dependency on the different test cases that we use within designing the system, and we have to test at the end when the system is built, integrated within this operational environment. We use therefore the normal SysML test cases and these kind of things to build up these kind of test cases. So at the operational level, it's based on the operational scenarios and the interaction diagrams. At the functional level, based on the structure diagrams and the activity diagrams. And at the lower level, we have to look at the PLDs and energy schemes, for example. There's a dependency between the design and the verification over there. So we can design it, but we have to manage also the project itself. So therefore, we have make additional elements within the toolboxes over there. For example, the design decisions, because on every state of requirements, you have to make a design decision as a start for the design. But we have to also look at the changes. What kind of changes are there? Because these projects have a very long schedule, 1 year, 2 years, 3 years. And we have to set up all the changes. We have to follow all the kind of issues, and we have to look at the project risk. But project management is not using enterprise architect as an environment. So we can give them a dashboard within Collaborate, so they can see the schedule and the progress within the schedule. They can see all the changes, the status of the changes, the project risk and the project deviation. So after a verification, what kind of deviation we have? Can we deliver the quality that we have agreed on? Are the project risks, are they mitigated, for example? What is the risk itself? Is it useful or not? Do we have to mitigate it? This kind of information does the project or the product management needed for these kind of projects. So at the end, we have built up one single source of truth where we can integrate all the domain specific information for the different kind of engineers. We can simulate certain parts of the system itself. We can analyze it by using Faultree and Hermias, for example, failure mode analysis, hazard analysis, and we can integrate it, the 3-day BIM models within Enterprise RStack to that we have the traceability always in place with it. I hope that that I give you some insight how we can use Enterprise RStack during the whole system lifecycle for retrofitting these kind of systems itself, because they are not new. They are parts of it will be always available or will be upgraded or modified in a later state of the system lifecycle. So we have to define the ease and the solve situation and deviation every time. That you can minimize it and deliver the quality products by the customer in the customer responsibility. I hope that it will be within your field of work that you can use this kind of information and the power of Enterprise RStack in relationship to collaborate to model also this kind of industrial system. Thank you. Are there any questions?
I thank Jan on behalf of everyone for making this session a wonderful one. As we said earlier, now is the time for Q&A. And we will be reading out the questions from the chat, and Jan will be answering them. Jan, Rob has asked you a question how have you created the PID and FTA diagrams? Is this an add-in to EA or developed in-house?
No, we have make an MDG that we can model. PIDs, one-eye schemes, and we can also model FMEAs, hazard analysis, and Faultree analysis. So that's an MDG that we have developed.
Okay, Jan, thank you. And Klaas has asked a question. You still have a document management system, or the structure the extra the same as the structure from your document?
Ask it again, please.
You still have a document management system?
Yes.
Or the structures extra the same as the structure for your document?
Yeah, you can publish from the model, you can publish documents in the same way as before, and you can store it in the document management system, but the source of truth is within the model. And when a model is changed, you can generate new documents.
Okay, Jan. That's all the question for now. So thanks, John, and thanks to everyone for your time and support throughout the session. Hope it is very informative and gives a deeper insight into the topic. Now, Jan will be available in the MS Teams to have a detailed discussion and answer all your questions. The link to the MS Teams is posted in the chat window for your quick reference. If anyone is having difficulties in connecting to Teams, please reach us the chat window or write us at registrations@daglobalsummit.com. Thanks once again, everyone, and looking forward to host you all in another wonderful session shortly. Thanks, Jan. Thanks, everyone.
Thank you. Thank everybody for being here. Bye.
Bye, John.